The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Pastor Greg Merriweather, Calvary Baptist Church of Haverstraw, New York, will deliver today's invocation. Pastor.
There's an old proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. And it's in this spirit that we pray on today. God in heaven, we thank you for this moment, this opportunity. Thank you for the ability to gather together. And most of all, we thank you for life, health, and strength. Every day is a gift. So on this day, we celebrate the gift of common minds. We celebrate the gifts of thoughts and opposing opinions. We celebrate the gifts of all of your children that's gathered here in creation on today. We could take deep breaths because we don't have to worry about much. Your word says it true, that if you take care of the birds that are in the trees, even such as a sparrow, we know that you will watch over us. So God, grant us the opportunity to join together in unity. We pray for your spirit, that it would guide us, that it would give us calm, that it would give us direction, and most of all, it would give us protection. We thank you again on today. Now bless every person that's gathered. Bless every area that they represent, every home, every household. Bless them as they come together to do the business of the state of New York. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Let all God's children say amen.
Reading of the journal.
In Senate, Monday, March 27, 2023, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Friday, March 24, 2023, was read and approved on motion to Senate adjourn.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the Assembly, messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator Gianaris.
Good afternoon, Madam President. I move to adopt the resolution calendar with the exception of Resolution 590.
All those in favor of adopting the resolution calendar with the exception of Resolution 590, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The resolution calendar is adopted. Senator Gianaris.
Can we begin by taking up previously adopted Resolution 516 by Senator May? We read that resolution's title and recognize Senator May.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution 516 by Senator May, memorializing Governor Kathy Hochul to proclaim April 2023 as Fair Housing Month in the state of New York.
Senator May on the resolution.
Thank you, Madam President. I rise today to commemorate the month of April as Fair Housing Month. In 1934, my grandfather bought a house for about $3,000 in a quiet neighborhood walking distance from his job at UCLA. He was a low-paid instructor, not even on tenure track, but the bank was willing to give him a mortgage because of a brand new Depression-era federal policy to back home loans with the full faith and credit of the US government. My grandparents lived there for 30 years until the neighborhood was overrun with rowdy movie stars, at which point they bought a house in a quieter neighborhood. But when they finally sold their second house in their 80s, they were able to pay for years of nursing care with enough left over to leave small nest eggs to all five grandchildren. So we were able to make down payments on homes of our own. The federally backed mortgage program was a spectacular success in promoting home ownership and building equity for millions of families like mine, but only for families that looked like mine. Black and brown families were explicitly excluded, which meant they were frozen out of the opportunity to build home equity, the major source of generational wealth. It is the main reason why Black Americans, who make up 13% of the U.S. population, hold only 4% of the wealth. It is also the main factor that has driven housing segregation in this country. Wherever you live, village, town, neighborhood, your community has been shaped by our shameful national history of housing discrimination. 55 years ago, President Johnson worked with members of Congress to pass the Fair Housing Act, a landmark federal law that prohibits discrimination in the provision of housing. Access to safe, affordable, and quality housing is critical to every single person in this state. And at the state level, we have expanded the principles of the Fair Housing Act to prohibit discrimination in housing based on things like age, sexual orientation, or source of income. In observing Fair Housing Month in 1984, President Reagan said, "This April, let us once again dedicate ourselves to the great work of assuring fair housing for all, and let us continue that work until fair housing becomes a permanent reality in our national life." In 2005, the Supreme Court ruled that policies segregating minorities in poor neighborhoods, even unintentionally, are against the law. As President Obama said in his remarks that year on Fair Housing Month, the court recognized what many people know to be true from their own lives, that too often where people live determines what opportunities they have in life. He also emphasized the important role of local governments in both creating and solving the problem, and his administration began the work of helping local governments meet that need by gathering data on housing and neighborhood conditions to help inform policymakers. The Fair Housing Act was signed in 1968. We've made tremendous progress in addressing discrimination through the tools it provides, but we all know there is much more to be done. Too often, the same families who lost out on the opportunities that my family benefited from are the ones disproportionately hurt by lack of housing, lack of affordable housing, the lack of credit and equity, inadequate code enforcement, arbitrary evictions, and quiet discrimination by realtors and lenders and zoning boards. We are joined today by the leader of CNY Fair Housing, Sally Santangelo. Her organization is leading the way in providing information to help policymakers and public defenders help us realize the goals of the Fair Housing Act. As we enter Fair Housing Month here in the state of New York, I urge all of us to keep the spirit of the Fair Housing Act alive. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator May. To our guests, I welcome you to the Senate chamber. We extend to you the privileges and courtesies of the House. Please rise and be recognized. The resolution was previously adopted on March 15th. Senator Gianaris.
Can we now move to Resolution 590 by Senator Cooney? Read that resolution's title and recognize Senator Cooney.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution 590 by Senator Cooney, commending Dan DiClemente for his many years of dedicated service to the Rochester City School District.
Senator Cooney on the resolution.
Thank you, Madam President. I'm sure that our colleagues in this chamber will agree that the best part of this job is that we're granted with opportunities to recognize and uplift individuals in our communities who go above and beyond in the service of their neighbors. You would be hard-pressed to find an individual more deserving of this recognition than Dan DiClemente. His biography speaks for himself. After working nearly a decade in the Rochester City School District, he was elected president of Bente Local 2419, charged with representing more than 1,200 non-teacher RCSD employees. And as president, Dan has not only negotiated the past five collective bargaining agreements, he's led demonstrations, spoken in front of the school board and members of the state legislature. And he founded a scholarship program for our students. In 2017, Dan was elected president of AFSCME Council 66, representing 8,500 public and nonprofit sector workers in upstate New York and the Hudson Valley. And on a personal note, as the first Rochester City School District graduate to be elected to the state legislature in decades, I've had a personal connection to all those who work in service of our city's children, including our AFSCME members. Dan has been a trusted voice, a fierce advocate, and relentless defender of workers' rights in the Rochester community, not only for his members, but for members across upstate New York. It's an honor and privilege to welcome Dan and his family and many colleagues and friends to Albany this afternoon. And it is my hope that we walk away not only with a deep appreciation for his contributions to our collective labor community, but we may be inspired by his integrity, his leadership in the movement, and his unshakable commitment to fight for those who may otherwise be voiceless. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Senator Cooney. Senator Brooke on the resolution.
Thank you, Madam President. I'm honored to stand here with my fellow Rochester Senator, Senator Cooney, as we welcome Dan DiClemente today and recognize him with this resolution. Dan is a beloved member of our Rochester community. Recognized for his steadfast championing of workers' rights in the Rochester City School District through Bente Local 2419, as well as for AFSCME New York Council 66 and the Rochester Area Labor Council Executive Board. Over the past few years, Dan has been a steady hand while leading his fellow union members through incredibly tumultuous times. I remember August 2020, we stood together with Bente members as they were losing their health benefits in the midst of a global pandemic. Even before I had the privilege of sitting in this seat, we pleaded with the school district to support workers in this massive time of need. And at a time when it was so hard to feel hopeful and the challenges were mounting, Dan not only supported his members who were scared of how they'd protect their own families, but he reached out to the larger community and ensured that these stories were being told and that we came together to help. Dan is a tireless champion for our school community, and I have been moved and inspired by his sacrifice and dedication to others. My work here in Albany to increase school budgets, champion our public schools, is all a direct response to the advocacy I have seen back home from Dan. To Dan, I want to say how grateful I am to have you as a community member, as a labor leader, and as a fierce partner in the work we do to improve this state for all New Yorkers. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you, Senator Brooke. To Mr. DiClemente and your friends and family, please be welcome to the Senate. It's an honor to have you here today. Please rise and be recognized. The question is on the resolution. All in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed? The resolution is adopted. Senator Gianaris.
Madam President, Senators May and Cooney would like to open their resolutions for co-sponsorship.
The resolution is open for co-sponsorship. Should you choose not to be a co-sponsor on the resolution, please notify the desk. Senator Gianaris.
There will be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
There will be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
The Senate will stand at ease.
The Senate will stand at ease. The Senate will return to order. Senator Gianaris.
There's a report of the Rules Committee at the desk. Can we take that up, please?
The Secretary will read.
Senator Stuart Cousin from the Committee on Rules reports the following bills. Senate Print 1319 by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law and the insurance law. Senate Print 5818A by Senator Myrie, an act to amend the election law. Senate Print 6061 by Senator Hoyman Siegel, an act to amend the judiciary law. All bills report directed third reading.
Move to accept the report of the Rules Committee.
All those in favor of accepting the report of the Rules Committee signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The report of the Rules Committee is accepted. Senator Gianaris.
Please take up the reading of the calendar.
The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 356, Senate Print 717 by Senator Claire, an act to amend the real property tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Gianaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Claire to explain her vote.
Thank you, Madam President. The Senior Citizens Rent Increase Exemption Program, SCRE, is one of the most important tools that we have to freeze rents for older New Yorkers who are often on a very fixed income but wish and deserve to age in the community they have lived in all their lives. In New York City, it applies to well over 100,000 households, but like so many benefits, has hard caps and cliffs that lock people out far too hastily. The purpose of this bill is to expand the population eligible to take advantage of SCRE by excluding all medical and prescription drug expenses not reimbursed or paid for by insurance from the definition of income for the purpose of determining eligibility for the program. By allowing these essential costs to be deducted, fewer individuals will exceed the income cap and will thus remain and or become eligible for the SCRE program and its many benefits. I wish to thank my beloved seniors at A. Philip Randolph Senior Center in my district for their advocacy and work on this bill and for lobbying me to pass it. And I just want to read a small portion of what they sent me about this bill. They said, we, the members of the A. Philip Randolph Senior Center located in the 30th Senatorial District, would like to express our heartfelt appreciation for your efforts to improve the lives of older adults in our state. Today, we hosted an advocacy day in support of a few of your aging legislative priorities, particularly Senate Bill S-717, which proposes a new definition of income to allow more people to be eligible for the Senior Citizen Rent Increase Exemption program. This important legislation will assist seniors like us and people across our state in affording their housing costs, enabling them to live more independently. I proudly vote aye and hope that everyone else does the same. Thank you.
Senator Clear to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce result.
In relation to calendar 356, vote in the negative. Senator Walzer, ayes 61, nays 1.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 391, Senate Print 4967 by Senator Jackson, an act to amend the Administrative Code of the City of New York.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Gianaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the result.
In relation to calendar 391, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Ashby, Borrello, Castaneda Fitzpatrick, Felder, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Lanza, Martins, Matera, Murray, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rhodes, Rollison, Steck, Tedisco, Walzick, Weber, and White, ayes 40, nays 22.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 394, Senate Print 1172 by Senator Harkham, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Gianaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the result.
In relation to calendar 394, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Borrello, Castaneda Fitzpatrick, Griffo, Helming, Martins, Matera, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rhodes, Steck, Tedisco, Walzick, and White. Ayes 47, nays 15.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 475, Senate Print 1468 by Senator Breslin, an act to amend the insurance law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Gianaris, Cooper, Ort, Sewell, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 506, Senate Print 4266A by Senator Webb, an act to establish a task force on missing women and girls who are black.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 60th day after the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Gianaris, Cooper, Ort, Sewell, Cousins, White.
Senator Webb, to explain her vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam President. I rise to explain my vote. This legislation will address the discrepancies and disparities for missing and murdered Black, Indigenous women and girls of color by instituting a task force on missing BIPOC women and girls in New York State. I just want to share a couple of statistics that demonstrate why this task force is necessary and why I hope my colleagues will support. According to a 2020 report by the Women's Media Center, there are approximately 75,000 missing Black women and girls across the United States. Another report released by the Sovereign Bodies Institute documents that there are over 2,306 missing Indigenous women and girls in the U.S. Nationally, more than 250,000 women and girls were reported missing in 2020, and at least 40% were women and girls of color, despite making up less than 15% of the population. And this came from the National Crime Information Center, NCIC, missing person and unidentified persons statistics. In addition, in a two-year review of all suspected national human trafficking incidents, 40% of sex trafficking women were identified as Black women. From 2016 to 2020, there was a 38% increase in the number of missing children. 31% of that increase was for Black children. And in 2020, the New York State Missing Persons Clearinghouse annual report shared that 59.8% of children reported missing were female, and 29.2% of them were Black. And so when you think about these stats, right, and included among the tens of thousands of these missing BIPOC women and girls are abductees, sex trafficking victims, and runaways that get grouped disproportionately, and that this thus impacts the intersection of both racism and sexism, and it is subjective to pervasive social and economic barriers. For these reasons, missing BIPOC girls are often categorized as runaways, which makes it more likely that their cases will be pushed aside and treated with a lack of urgency. This is an epidemic that unfortunately is being rendered silent, and we as a state owe it to these women and their families to do better. This task force will develop policy changes within New York State government agencies to address the lack of care and concern for missing and murdered BIPOC women and girls, including that our first responders are also culturally competent. This task force will ensure that there is transparency when it comes to the numbers of missing and murdered BIPOC women and girls, so that communities understand the scale of this problem. This task force will also make sure that communities are educated and trained on the prevention, protection, and protocols relating to missing BIPOC women and girls as it relates to social media, and will recommend preventative programming and ideas to protect vulnerable women and girls. Madam President, this legislation will take a crucial step to make visible missing BIPOC women and girls in the public discussion. By developing this task force on this crisis, New York has an opportunity to not only take charge, but also acknowledge the work that has to be done to bring justice for missing BIPOC women and girls. I would like to thank our Majority Leader for her support on this initiative, And I will be voting aye, and I encourage my colleagues to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Webb to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Ramos to explain her vote.
Thank you. I want to begin by thanking Senator Webb for being a chair that truly values intersectionality and for this very thoughtful bill. You know, when we speak about Indigenous people, we often think of them as human beings from the past, some sort of relic, and that couldn't be farther from the truth. Indigenous people are part of our communities, particularly in mine, and I, of course, always share how proud I am of my own Indigenous heritage. And that's why I want to point out that, you know, the genocide that started with Christopher Columbus has never actually really ended. I have a few stats to share myself. Native women face murder rates more than 10 times the national average. Homicide is the third leading cause of death among Native girls and women aged 10 to 24, and the fifth leading cause of death for Native women aged 25 to 34. The median age for missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls is 29. And unfortunately, we have to note that the conditions that make women most vulnerable to violence is poverty. Native American women are typically paid only 60 cents for every dollar paid to a white non-Hispanic man. And that pay gap is typically around $2,055 every month, or nearly $25,000 every year. And as we know, especially on our side of the aisle, poverty makes everybody unsafe. And here we're sharing that it particularly makes Indigenous women unsafe. So I, of course, want to use this opportunity to implore you all to support our Raise the Wage Act as we're closing in on budget negotiations. And I vote aye, Madam President.
Senator Ramos to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Fernandez to explain her vote.
Thank you so much, Madam President. I truly want to thank the sponsor for putting this bill forward and to initiate the creation of this task force. It really can't be stressed enough the crisis that is in our communities, in everyone's district here, and especially like mine in the Bronx, where every other 99-cent store, grocery store, the 5x5 bulletin is covered with missing girls, missing kids. And it is a crisis. This task force, as it was detailed, is going to do so much to empower our young people, our old people, those that are vulnerable to this crime, to this evil that is human trafficking. And we really need to get to the bottom of it. We need to find the solutions. We need to stop the trafficking. We need to stop whatever is incentivizing girls to go missing and to fall into these terrible hands. So thank you for bringing this to the floor. Thank you for highlighting something that doesn't get highlighted often. Every time we see of a missing person, a young woman, it's never to the extent that we see of a young white woman given to the same extent, or given to the a young black or brown woman. It's just not the same. The attention is not the same, and we need to start making it the same. We need to start really getting to the bottom of how this is happening, why it's happening, and empowering and educating our communities to prevent it from happening. So I really thank this. I encourage everyone, please vote aye, because lives are being lost, lives are disappearing, and it's time that we put a stop to it. Thank you. I vote aye.
Senator Fernandez to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Clear to explain her vote.
I want to thank Senator Webb for this important bill. As a black woman, in my community, I have seen many women go missing, and often I've accompanied families to law enforcement, and the same energy is not put behind finding them, the same regard, the same care. We're all members of somebody's family. This is somebody's sister, somebody's daughter, maybe even somebody's mother. And in some cases, I have even had to look for people who were somebody's mother. Until we respect and protect every single woman, then we are not doing our job. We are not serving justice to females. And I can't tell you enough how much this bill means to me and many other families. We're simply written off as runaways, or written off as it doesn't matter, it's not worth looking for them. And this is so important. I encourage every one of my colleagues to vote aye on this today. There are so many families who have suffered. We have had missing children that have never been found. If you know the impact that that could have, think about your own child and never ever finding that child again. It's horrific. But on top of that, to feel as if no one's even looking is even worse. So I thank you for this bill today, and I proudly vote aye.
Senator Clear to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Brooke to explain her vote.
Thank you, Madam President. And I want to congratulate and thank my colleague, Senator Webb, for really being deliberate in her advocacy as she has progressed with this bill to make sure that we are taking into account many different perspectives and create the most sound bill possible. And I also, as so many of my women of color colleagues have pointed out, this country has a very long history of discounting, forgetting, disrespecting Black women and women of color. We're left out of history books. We're not considered in a lot of policy-making decisions, although this body, that doesn't happen anymore. And this bill is a way to not just correct some of those historical wrongs, but also to tell, as Senator Clear said, to tell our young girls that they matter. I'm sitting here getting ready to celebrate the first birthday. That's why we need an on-time budget, to celebrate the first birthday of my little Black baby girl. And I think about how she is the world to me. And to think that there are mothers out there who don't believe law enforcement or those in charge care that their child is missing is heartbreaking to me. So thank you again to Senator Webb, because these things need to get attention. These things need to be talked about. These things need to be acted upon. And that's why I proudly stand with my colleague and so many of our colleagues who have voted aye on this bill. And I hope that it is not the end of the work that we do to better recognize these wrongs in our society, but the beginning. Thank you.
Senator Brooke to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 508, Senate Print 2103A by Senator Harkin, an act to amend the environmental conservation law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannakis, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, Wyke.
Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 520, Senate Print 1839 by Senator Sanders, an act to amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannakis, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, Wyke.
Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 524, Senate Print 3131 by Senator Mannion, an act directing the Commissioner of Health to conduct a study on the rates of reimbursement made through the New York State Medicaid durable medical equipment.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannakis, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, Wyke.
Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 540, Senate Print 1250 by Senator Salazar, an act to establish an LGBTQ youth and young adult suicide prevention task force.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 60th day of shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannakis, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, Wyke.
Senator Brisport to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. And I really want to thank Senator Salazar for bringing this bill to us. I'm a former public school teacher, and I recall a time I had to ride an emergency vehicle with a student who had expressed they wished to take their own life. I've also had to experience making a call to a mother to let her know that her 11-year-old son was considering taking his own life, which is a call that no parent wants to receive. Mostly an openly gay legislator, proudly gay, and I say open and proud because too many people in the community are told not to be open and proud. Too many of our youth are told not to be open and proud. And too many youth take their lives. The rates among LGBTQ plus youth are even higher, and I want these kids to live. So I proudly vote aye, and thank you.
Senator Brisport to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Hoylman-Siegel to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President, and thank you to my colleague, Senator Brisport, and mostly thank you to Senator Salazar for this important bill. You know, a war is being waged against LGBTQ kids in nearly half the states in this country. According to the ACLU, there are 434 anti-LGBTQ bills in state houses like this across the country, 434 and counting. Government officials are signaling to the general public that it's acceptable to discriminate against and fear LGBTQ people, and the hatred too often falls on our kids. In our schools, 9 out of 10 LGBTQ students reported being harassed and bullied last year, and over a third of LGBTQ students reported being physically assaulted at school because of their sexual orientation and gender identity. And really, as a result of this vitriol, this nationwide vitriol that is being magnified and amplified by state legislatures, many of our LGBTQ youth are suffering mentally. And I'll end with this. The Trevor Project found that 45% of LGBTQ youth seriously considered attempting suicide in the past year, including half of transgender and non-binary youth in New York State, half in our state. So I really do thank Senator Salazar for this important legislation to get a handle on suicide among LGBTQ youth and take steps to prevent it. I vote aye. Thank you.
Senator Holman Siegel to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Scarsella Banton to explain your vote.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Senator Salazar, for pushing this legislation forth. I just wanted to really commend this legislation. It's so incredibly important. Just this weekend on Staten Island, we had a 20-year-old young man who took his own life for being bullied for his sexual preference. This is unacceptable, and we have so much work to be done. And I want to highlight that on Staten Island, it's one of the few places left in our St. Patrick's Day parade where our Pride Center isn't allowed to march. Having that out there in public, having these young men and women who don't feel accepted by their own community is harmful, and I really just wanted to thank you, and I proudly vote aye.
Senator Scarsella Banton to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Salazar to explain her vote.
Thank you, Madam President, and thank you to my colleagues for supporting this legislation. Suicide among LGBTQ teenagers and young people in New York is a crisis. Suicide is the third leading cause of death among young people ages 15 to 24 years old in New York City. And LGBTQ youth face especially high risks of suicide or self-harm. 1 out of every 3 transgender young people in New York City have seriously thought about taking their lives. And 2 out of every 5 report having made a suicide attempt. During a time when LGBTQ young people and transgender youth in particular are being targeted across the country with harmful laws intending to erase trans existence, it should come as no surprise to us that these children are experiencing alarming levels of suicidal ideation and self-harm. This is a moment for New York to respond with unequivocal support and love for queer and trans youth in the face of bigotry. This task force will help us better understand the specific causes and factors that lead to higher risk of suicide among young people, such as trauma and oppression based on their sexuality and gender identity, so our state can take meaningful action to prevent suicide and self-harm. Madam President, I vote aye.
Senator Salazar to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 548, Senate Print 4131 by Senator Mannion, an act to amend the tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 5, this act takes effect on the 1st of January.
Call the roll.
Dabo, Gianaris, Kruger, Ortsuer, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 552, Senate Print 2691 by Senator Breslin, an act to amend the general municipal law.
Read the last section.
Section 6, this act takes effect on the 90th day after it shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Dabo, Gianaris, Kruger, Ortsuer, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Aye, 62.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 558, Senate Print 5176 by Senator Thomas, an act authorizing the World Restoration Center Incorporated to receive retroactive real property tax exemption status.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act takes effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adabo, Gianaris, Kruger, Ortsuer, Cousins, White.
Announce results.
In relation to calendar 558, voted in the negative, Senator O'Mara, aye 61, nays 1.
The bill is passed. Senator Gianaris, that completes the reading of today's calendar.
Is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business at the desk.
I move to adjourn until tomorrow, Wednesday, March 29th at 3 p.m.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Wednesday, March 29th at 3 p.m.